Boats in Roblox are usually pretty hard to get right. The water physics in the default Roblox water is kinda meh, and a lot of times getting constraints to play how you want them to is quite difficult. But in this video, using the power of plane constraints, vector forces, torques, and like align orientation, you'll be able to make a nice boat like the one I have here. And this boat will be very tunable. There's a bunch of values you can change to make it sluggish or as fast or as responsive as you want, depending on what your game may need. I'm really proud of this, and I hope you really enjoy it as much as I do, because naval vehicles in Roblox are just hard to make. They're very hard to make. So I hope you enjoy this video. Make sure to watch my other constraint videos as well. And without further ado, let's get started. Oh, and don't forget to like and subscribe. Okay, so I'm here in a Roblox Studio project with some terrain surrounding me, and we also got a little boat model right here. All it is a bunch of parts and unions, and then there's this one base part, which is a transparent non-can collide part that just covers the general like span of the boat. And this will be useful for when we put our vector forces and other forces down the line. And then we also have an ocean part. Keep in mind, I'm not using terrain water in this example. I'm using a separate part. If you want to use terrain water, you totally can. You're just going to have to configure your collision groups to have a separate one for terrain and then a separate one for the boat. But it'll also mean the boat kind of like will be able to phase through terrain. I don't know. It's a little too complicated for what it's worth, in my opinion. So if you really want terrain water for the looks, it's possible, but it'll be a doozy. Because the water physics affect everything. You just can't turn it off. It is really dumb. But we have our model. We have everything. We also need a vehicle seat. I'm going to make a vehicle seat real quick. A vehicle seat is what will help us drive the boat. And that will be quite useful, you know, obviously, because we want to drive it. Make sure you right-click on the vehicle seat and do show orientation indicator. And it should be facing the front of your boat. If it's not, then make sure to rotate it so it is. So I'm going to go and align it to the best of my ability. This actually seems pretty aligned. Make it a little smaller. Here is our vehicle seat. Boom. So this will help us drive the boat. And so now we have everything together. I'm going to select all of my parts. Go to create weld. That will create a bunch of welds between them. If you don't see these green lines and identifying the welds, go to model and show welds. And this will allow you to see all the welds and make sure everything is nice and secure. So now that we got everything welded up nice and well, we need to verify that all of the parts other than the base have massless turned on. So we can go down to properties and we can turn massless on. And this means that the parts won't actually affect the mass other than the base, because it leads to imbalances and like center of mass kind of stuff with constraints. It's nasty. We don't want that. And make sure your base has massless turned off, because the base should be the only part where the mass actually matters. So now let's create our plane constraint to actually keep the boat from sinking. So we're going to create this plane constraint. Actually, first off, we are going to create a new part. And this part can just be wherever, but it should be at sea level. So this part is going to house our plane constraint. It doesn't really matter what it looks like or, like, you know, because in your actual game, you'll make it invisible. And we're going to create a plane constraint, put the first attachment point on top of this new part, and then put the second attachment point on top of our base. Make sure the second attachment point is connected to the base. And I'm actually going to move this down. The reason I place it on the top is you want the yellow lines of these two attachments to be like parallel to each other. See how this little plane thing is there? This is the plane in which the plane constraint is going to keep our boat. So I'm going to move this down about to where I want the boat to sit in the water. So I want it to sit in water like about there. That should be good enough, I think. Yeah. I don't know. I hope that's good. And then we're going to move the boat down just a little bit. There we go. And that should be good. So now they're like the red line's gone, which means they're aligned in the plane. I'm going to make sure this part here is actually anchored and can collides off. because it's going to be invisible. Let's make it invisible now. So it just doesn't really exist. And we're going to name this, I'm just going to name it the plane part, because this part is going to contain the plane. Now, if you're cloning this boat model from server storage, you're going to have to clone both the model and the plane part every time, just so, you know, they're in parity. And make sure the plane part is at your sea level. I know it's kind of clanky to put a separate part to put, like, where the boat's going to sit. But I don't know. If you really wanted to, you could just duplicate plane constraints on, like, the ocean part that you're using. So, like, this big ocean part, I can make a plane constraint that, like, you know, deals with it. But it's always up to you. So let's play this and make sure the boat actually is on the plane. So it does stay on the plane, but you'll note it is not very stable. So we need to fix that. We're going to be using an align constraint for that. So I'm going to go to create or align orientation. And I actually have a video on this if you want to check it out. And we're going to place it there. And you can place the other attachment wherever you want, I guess. We're going to delete it. We're going to use one attachment mode for the align constraint and make sure it's on the base. I just reuse that same attachment. It's up to you whether or not you want to. And I'm going to make the mode one attachment because we don't need two attachments. I don't know why all of these body movers in Roblox insist on two attachments, but whatever. Then we're going to change the align type to primary axis parallel. So what this does is, our boat has an orientation like thing, and it's like right now, you know, it's facing up and down, whatever. We need it to maintain that the primary axis of our align constraint aligns with the primary axis of this attachment. Right now, the primary axis of this is on its side. We want it to be up. So we're going to do 0, 1, 0 for the primary axis. And that means the line, the yellow line of the align constraint is facing up, and the yellow line of our attachment is facing up. Everything is right in the world, and it should float just fine. Well, it's still not strong enough. We can fix that, though. We can go in, increase the max torque a little bit, increase the responsiveness a little bit. Oh, shoot, I accidentally deleted it. And that should fix it. Let's play it again. Yeah, so now it's pretty solid. You know, it's not budging. It's not moving around too much. Even if we, like, move it up, it'll snap to place. And nothing will make it fall over, which is good. That's exactly what we want. So the boat is now stable in the water. Okay, so now we need a way to propel the boat. So for this, I'm going to go to create vector force and put the vector force on my base. Make sure it's on your base about where you expect the boat to drive. So I'm going to put it here. I'm going to make sure it's centered. See if it's centered. I'm going to go to the transform in the corner. Make sure it actually is centered. Oh, it's centered there. And then I'm actually going to make my attachment a little bit lower. Just because you'll see it'll allow the boat to actually raise in the water. Like, you know, in real life when motorboats go across, like the back kind of dips and the front kind of raises. If you lower your little attachment point, it'll do that naturally, which is pretty cool. And you also want to go down to your axis and flip it so that the little yellow line is facing forward. And by the way, use constraint details to see all of this stuff. I probably should have mentioned that earlier, but use constraint details. Keep that in mind, sorry, to see, like, the attachments and stuff. And so you see this little blue line? That's, like, the current, you know, force that's facing that way. So if we run this, it should just, like, drive forward. Yeah, so it drives forward. Pretty cool. Now let's script it. So let's go into our base crew, or let's go into our boat model. I'm actually going to name this boat. And then I'm also going to rename the vector force to motor just to make more sense. And then I'm going to go into the boat, create a new script. And we're going to call the script the boat script. And then I'm actually going to get rid of this. This is annoying. Okay, we're going to say local boat equals script.parent local motor equals boat.base.motor. And then We're also going to get the seat, local seat equals boat.vehicle seat. And we're also going to get run service. So the reason we're getting run service is that we need to run a function every single stepped event, every single physics tick. So I'm going to create a function called drive boat. And this will take in two parameters, both of which we're not going to use. So I'm going to use a double underscore here to kind of say like, hey, yeah, like, I know we're getting two parameters, but we're not going to use them. They're like time and delta time. We don't need time or delta time. Like, it really don't matter. So we're going to, first of all, get the thrust by saying it equals seat.throttleFloat times some constant. So I'm going to do like, I'm going to do a lot. So I'm going to do probably a million to start out with because this boat's kind of chunky. And then I'm going to do local turn equals seat.steerFloat. So actually we don't need this variable. So what this throttle float and steer float are is they're like values, they're properties of the seat, and they change whenever you press WASD or joysticks or mobile touchpad whenever you drive. So we're gonna use that to like, you know, control the boat. So I'm gonna set the motor.force equal to cframe.angles 0 math.py divided by, let's start out with like 12, times seat.steerFloat 0.writeVector times thrust. This is a lot, but what we're basically doing here is like, you know how in real life boats can't turn when they're stopped? So we're taking this idea and we're actually modeling a boat more accurately by basically rotating the vector of thrust. So like, whenever the boat goes straight, that's the only time it's like vector of thrust can be rotated. So we're basically like turning the motor. Like, you know, in motorboats, how they have the motor on the back and like it kind of goes side to side. We're doing that, but with C-frame math. So usually the right vector is facing just straight, like front and back on the boats, because we use the X on the vector force to like go forward and back. Usually Z is forward and back, but just because of attachments, this is how it's set up. The primary axis is X. So, and then depending on the steer float, we rotate it by some amount. And this is, I'm using math.py because this is in radians. So it's not degrees. It's just easier to use this way. But really all you got to know is raising this number makes the, like the turn amount tighter. Lowering this number makes you able to like turn more and quicker. And yeah. So we also have to connect this function by saying run service.stepped connect dry boat. Make sure there's no parentheses there. And then we can play the game. So I'm going to go find my boat and then go to play here. Where is that test? Run, play here. There you go. So I'm going to play on top of the boat. Oh, that is fast. That is very fast. Okay, well, obviously, a million is not a good number. Let's go down to like 10,000, I guess. I don't know. Okay, let's try this again. Yeah, so here you go. Notice how we're not stopping. That's an issue. But you also notice that you literally cannot turn unless you're like driving forward, which I think is a really good feature of a boat and of a boat's handling. So now that we have this like kind of set up, before you start going and tuning these numbers, like bringing this number up and down here, we need to address like the elephant in the room is that like there's no damping. Like in real life, water kind of slows you down when you're going fast and like when you're turning. We don't have that right now. So, and it's pretty easy to add. So I'm going to go to model and create a new vector force. This is going to be our damping, like our linear damping. And I'm going to reuse the same attachment because why not? Because all we're doing is making it relative to the world. And I'm going to make sure it's force zero. And we're also going to apply it at the center of mass. This is just going to act against the like velocity that we currently have. So I'm going to rename this to linear damping. And then I'm going to create a torque object by going to create torque. Where is it? Here we go. And this is going to counteract our rotational velocity. I'm going to call it rot damping. And then make sure it's zero initially, and then make sure it's relative to the world. And then that should be good. So both of those should be good to go. Then we go back into our boat script. We say local linear damp equals boat.base.linear damping, and local rot damp equals boat.base.rotation damping. And then down inside of our dry boat function, we're going to say linear damp dot force equals negative seat dot assembly linear velocity times some constant that you can tune yourself. I'm going to start at 100. So this basically says, okay, wherever we're going, like what velocity we're going at, we're going to counteract it and we're going to slow us down. We're going to do the same thing for rot damping. Sorry, rot damp dot torque equals negative seat dot assembly angular velocity times some constant. I'm gonna say 1,000. So this basically says like, okay, you're gonna slow down rotationally, slow down linearly, so it just acts more like water, and like you don't just drive off into infinity. So we're gonna try this out. Oh, I missed the boat. That is very sad. We're going to put our player here again. There we go. Okay, here we go. So we drive, it everything works out nicely. And then notice we still kind of whip around, and you can tune these values, but we stop, which is exactly what we want. You know, like we slow down and we eventually stop. This is actually working great. So I'm going to tune this a little bit more, and then I'll be back and show you the finished product. So after a while of tuning, this is what I have. It drives pretty nicely. I can turn, but it doesn't turn out of control, which is nice, but it still has a tight turning radius. It's kind of floaty, but kind of responsive. And, you know, this is a game, so it doesn't have to be fully accurate to a real-life boat. But I think this does a semi-decent job of, you know, getting the point across of a speedboat. So here are my stats, if you want to take them. So this value here, the more you increase it, the more the boat will like resist turning, so you'll have a wider turning radius. The more this value goes up, the wider your turning radius. The more linear damp that goes up, the more responsive it is. It'll stop quicker and it'll be less floaty. It'll be less like dragging through the air. The higher your thrust is the faster you go, but it also means you turn faster. And the higher this number is, like the angle, means the slower you turn, the less powerful you turn, because it's constricting the angle. Since we're doing math.pi divided by this number, we're constricting the angle. So the bigger this number is, the more the angle is constricted. So yeah. And then in my line orientation, here are all the stats. And I also moved the attachment here to the center of the boat. And that makes things a little better with the plane constraint, because everything, like the plane constraint and stuff, rotates around that. So yeah. So this is the boat basically done. And if you want to use it like in server storage and stuff, you can just store the boat and the plane part like together and then just duplicate it every time, and that should be good to go. And it should work fine. And you can put the plane part wherever you want as long as the Y is in the right place in your world for the boat. But yeah, that's about it. So let me know if you have any questions in the comments. I think this does a pretty good job of like being a nice boat. Let me know what you think. And make sure to like and subscribe if you enjoy this kind of content. Give me suggestions and questions down below. And with that, I hope you have a nice day, and goodbye.